Marissa Haverty. Freshman, number 32, Kate Schaefer. Ladies and gentlemen, we ask that you please rise as we honor America with the singing of our national anthem, performed by Conard Solo Choir.
Say good afternoon and welcome to Lacrosse Day in West Hartford. The War Chief Sports Council on WHC TV Channel 5 proud to present West Hartford High School Sports today. Doubleheader action as Hall plays Conard in both girls and boys lacrosse. Hi again, everybody. Pete Lammer along with Steve Boyle and our fine crew led by Chen Evans. First up, a girls battle, second matchup of the season as the Chieftains go for the sweep of the season series, winning the opener at Hall back in April 2nd by the score of 15-5. Meg Sasebo on the home team. team on one heck of a roll. They've won 8 in a row, come in at 12-2 on the year, and currently ranked 3rd in Class L for the upcoming state tournament. Veteran team, 5 seniors, led by Marissa Haverty, who has 41 goals on her way, playing to Assumption next year. Hall, only 3-11. But a young group under Meg Chaplin has won 2 of their last 3, led by junior Cammy Cho, has 50 goals to pace the team. Very pleased to be joined by former Hall coach Steve Boyle, who won all 4 of these Hall-Conard matchups when he coached the Warriors. Steve, welcome. And what can Hall do to slow down this juggernaut known as the Chieftains this afternoon?
Thanks for having me, Pete. Well, it's certainly going to be a challenge. The disparity this year has been, obviously in Conard's favor. And, the funny thing about lacrosse is that it's a game that you could literally never have the ball the entire game. It's not like a team scores and you're going to get possession back. So it truly is a possession game. You know, people talk about possession a lot to sports, but this one probably more than any other. So the key for Hall to be able to win this game today is to win as many draws as they can, limit their turnovers, force turnovers when they can, and if they can possess 75 to 80% of the game, keep the score under 10, I think they got a chance to upset Conner today.
You and I were there in the rain back on April 2nd at Chalmers Stadium when Conard posted the 15-5 win. What in particular did they do well that day to win by such a lopsided score?
You know, it's funny. Again, lacrosse, you can watch it, and it's a game of spurts. And so you put on 3 or 4 spurts, and it's game over. There were times early on where it looked like Hall was going to hang around, and Conard had 2 bunches, particularly in the second half, that made all the difference. So there it is, first draw control, first possession is on the side.
It's Geisler that has the ball as they're on the attack for the first time. Gwen Geisler, racehorse, 4.12 GPA, as she really excels here on the field as well as in the classroom. Now they set it up. This is Marissa Haverty. Scored goal number 100 in her career, and there she goes again as she scores the first goal of the game just 27 seconds into the contest.
47 seconds into the first quarter.
It was a great move. She's both hands well. Nice lefty goal right there. Conard does something in basketball that we would consider slip screens, where they just sort of create confusion, and they created some movement off ball there, and Hall got stuck a little bit and missed the assignment. So this is called the draw control in girls lacrosse. When the boys play later, they call it a face-off. And so here we go on another draw. So that was called an empty right there on number 11, Siobhan Boyle. I actually know her a little bit.
That's Steve's daughter, of course, the youngest of his kids, who missed 4 games with a concussion, just her second game back. This is Cammy Cho speeding through the midfield for Hall. Big score, 50 goals on the campaign, as Hall has their first attack of the afternoon. Ball is loose, about 10 yards in front of the net. And what's the call again, Steve?
That's called an empty again, and so that's going to give, it looks like number 3, who's number 3? My eyes aren't great here. Hold on. Oh, no, that was Josie Lynch who got the possession. So it was a free position, and they chose not to go to goal on it. And so now we're going into what's called settled offense, and Hall will undoubtedly try to possess as much as they can.
And this is Cammy Cho with the ball for Hall, and her shot goes in, and she has tied the game with her 51st goal of the campaign. So if you do the math, 15 games, 51 goals. That's 3.4 goals per game. That's more than a hat trick per contest in hockey parlance. It's pretty good.
I've always tried to, as being a multi-sport guy, I've always tried to do what the parallels are. So I always equate 5 points in basketball to being about one goal. So she's about a 15-point game in basketball when you convert her goal. So Cammy's a speed demon. When I had her when she was a freshman, We used to call a play that we'd call sideshow. Cammy Cho, the sideshow. She was a one-man fast break, and she'd just go down the sideline. But she's an all-New England track star as well and a soccer player to boot. So she's a great athlete like her sister Hannah was.
And being the buff that you are with physical literacy, that's great to see. I'm sure you're gratified to see her playing multiple sports like that.
Absolutely.
So here's Conard trying to answer. We're tied at one. We've played 2 minutes here in the opening half on Lacrosse Day here in West Hartford. Glad you've joined us on W8CTV Channel 5 as presented by the War Chief Sports Council. There's a shot and a save made by the goalkeeper, Gabrielle Gershon. Talking to Meg Chaplin, she said, you know, 40% is a good save percentage, and she's exceeded that so far this year. Good goaltending tandem with Gershon as well as the freshman Maya Borden.
Yeah, one of the big concerns with the graduation of Madison Hooper, Maddie Hooper, who was an All-American and is now playing at the University of Connecticut, was the goalie position. And, you know, it's a real competitor's position, and it takes that's a nice little check and steal there by Kate, freshman Kate Schaefer. She's got tremendous speed. And Kate's getting a lot of quality minutes for Conard this year, and I know they've been really happy with her play.
So here's Conard, again in a 1-1 tie, 21:50 time remaining here in the first half. This is Gwen Geisler coming out in front with a shot. And a nice stop by the goaltender Gershon. So there's two in a row, keeping this game tied in the early stages of the opening half. And it's a Hall team that's 3-11 on the season, but they've won two out of their last three. And according to head coach Meg Chaplin, really have shown signs of coming around. She said one thing to watch for today when her team is on offense is that they're spread out and continually moving and moving their feet. She said when they don't do that, the offense tends to bog down. They tend to get stagnant. And those are the days that they don't score double digits.
Exactly. So, you know, going back to the goalie position with Gabby Gershon, she came out for Lacrosse having never played it at all before. She was a soccer kid who liked playing a little basketball. And with the graduation of Maddie, they just basically said, look, we're looking for anybody that wants to try the position out. And Gabby's got that great sort of aggressive mentality. She's got really good eye-hand coordination. And she's been an absolute standout for them and has kept them in a lot of games. Then they have a wonderful freshman goalie with Maya Borden as well. So between the two of them, goalie looks pretty strong moving forward.
Got a chance to see Maya playing for Brett Soucy's hockey team during the winter, where she was the third line center as a freshman. Played extremely well. This is Cho. Loses control, battling for the loose ball, still loose. And this is an area that Hall has not excelled at, according to Coach Chaplin. They're not getting those loose balls. They're not good on the turnovers. And that has resulted in a disparity of offensive attacks and the reason why they've been on the short end of a lot of scores so far this year. Let's talk about Conard a little bit. 8 straight wins, 12-2. Meg Sirsasimo in her sixth year as the head coach of this team and really has done quite a job, hasn't she, Steve?
She really has. And again, it is a young group. Meg has got a terrific staff with Rachel Tringali and Jill Jangris supporting her. They have just a really positive approach. Like all competitors, they'd like to have a record that was more commensurate with their efforts, but they have the long-term approach to this and recognize too that, you know, the experience is more than just wins and losses. It's about creating positive memories and learning life lessons, and sometimes you learn just as much in defeat as you do in victory. So, I can tell you as a parent in the program, I couldn't be happier to have my daughter with such terrific female role models. So I'm grateful for that.
Great pass in the middle. And a whistle on the play at the 18:44 mark of this opening half. Conard going for their 9th consecutive win. Talking about head coach Meg Sirsasimo as they score. And Hall has their first lead of the afternoon as Caroline Grant scores. That's her 21st goal of the season. And it's 2-1. Hall has their first advantage.
So Cammie Cho and Caroline Grant were the two freshmen we had in my final year. And now with them both as juniors, they've really have sort of led the team offensively. Caroline had a nice little look down as if she was going to do a bounce shot and went upper right corner. And it's almost like a look-away pass in basketball. You want to try to move the goalie, make them think you're going to shoot in a place that you're not. And that was a really nice shot by Caroline there, who's on the draw right now. It's a nice draw control by Gwen Geisler. Caroline tried to block her out after the draw went up, but Gwendolyn was able to get it over the top of her.
And Gwen, who has 10 goals in a three-game span against Simsbury, East Catholic, and Granby Memorial, so she's really been on fire from an offensive perspective. Marissa Haverty plays catch on the perimeter. Feigenbaum also out there, as they are the two goal-scoring threats for this Conard team, 40-plus goals on the season. And there's another one as they score. This one is Gwen Geisler. So she ties the game at the 6:10 mark of this opening half, and it is 2-2. We were talking before about Meg Srusasimo. Coached 5 years at UConn as an assistant, then 2 years at the head coaching position at her alma mater. She was recruited to play at UConn many years ago from Pennsylvania. That's where she met her present husband, Matt, head coach of the football team. She's done a marvelous job, hasn't she?
Well, it's funny that we're here at Conard, because the first time I ever saw Coach Srusasimo coach, I was actually coaching track and field here. And I remember my wife was a Division I lacrosse player and had coached girls for years and has been the athletic director and coach over at the Watkinson School. So I knew girls lacrosse a little bit, certainly not to the extent that I do now. But I just remember watching the intensity she had and how much fun she was having with the kids and the energy she brought. And then she and I became good friends through the process of coaching together. And she is I'll be quite honest, she's a heck of a lot better coach than I ever was. I think in the years that I was at the helm, I probably had the better players as lacrosse players. Certainly, we don't talk about better kids, better people, but I had better players, and therefore I was able to have greater success during those years. But Megan nearly got me a couple times, and I think at the end of games, often better players are often going to win. But Meg also coaches in the Nor'easter Lacrosse Club and does a great job with that program as well.
Again, one of those years you were talking about was 2012, when Hall won 15-13. Conard won the game last year. Steve won the previous four matchups, as Hall won in 2012, 13, 14, and 15, as well as 2011, as they have won 5 of the last 7 matchups against this Conard team. But Conard winning the opener 15-5 back on April 2nd. As they go for the victory here this afternoon. We're tied at 2, 16 minutes to go in the opening half. Conard on the attack as they set things up. Good penetration there, and another great save by the goaltender, Gershot. That's 3 in a row, Steve, by my calculations.
Yeah, she's been a wall back there. Sometimes goalies can get hot depending on where the shots are coming from. But those were legit saves. It wasn't as if they were just ones that were shot at her. So she's got to make decisions based on where the shot's going. So we've got a timeout right now. In girls lacrosse, you get 2 timeouts per game. You can use them however you want, whenever you want. So 4 total is the most we would see.
And the War Chief Sports Council would like to thank our many fine sponsors to help us out with broadcasts like today, including those at the all-state level: Keating Insurance, MACA Plumbing and Heating, Reed and Reach PC Counselors at Law, ESPN, the Conard and Hall PTO, and Mr. and Mrs. Jonathan Gibson. Those are the all-state level supporters, and we'd like to thank one and all for their patronage to the War Chief Sports Council. A reminder that we'll have the boys game coming your way if you're watching the live broadcast today. We'll be on with that one at 6 o'clock tonight. And then we'll culminate the spring sports season with the presentation of baseball next Monday. It'll be the Mayor's Cup, May the 23rd. And as always, over the last few years or so, we go to the University of Hartford for that one as Hall takes on Conard. Conard goes for their revenge in season. And Hall goes for their revenge in terms of the Mayor's Cup, which was won by Conard a year ago. So 4:30 is first pitch on Monday afternoon. Hall against Conard baseball right here on WHC-TV Channel 5 as presented by the War Chief Sports Council. Pete Lamoureux along with Steve Boyle. We're at Robert J. McKee Stadium here in West Hartford on the campus of Conard High School. 15:35 to play in this opening half after the timeout with the game tied at 2. Conard drawing first blood. Hall scoring 2 in a row to tie. Conard has the most recent goal, and thus we are all equal 9.5 minutes in to this opening half. Conard currently third in Class L. They have just 2 losses on the season. Glastonbury and Staples were the ones to defeat them. Games that Megster Sosmo said were both winnable games for her squad, and she looks forward to at least matching what they did a year ago in the state tournament, that is getting all the way to the semifinals before they were knocked out by Darien. Big story this year, Darien actually has a loss, Steve.
Don't bring up the name Darien to me. They ended certainly probably the strongest of our chances. I returned a group. We got a goal right there by Kylie Phelan. So if you notice, we've had 5 goals. 3 of them have been left-handed, 2 of them have been right-handed, and I'll talk a little bit more about that in a bit. But with Darien, they've always been ranked nationally, and so I had returned a roster that had everybody but one starter coming back. And we knew we were going to have a legit squad, and we had a good game plan going in, and we wound up tying them for all but 7 minutes. They had a 7-minute stretch where they went from 1-1 to 7-1, and the rest of the game, we tied them. So that was Siobhan doing a little basketball right there. She did the draw and then blocked her out, and then Caroline was able to come in. So again, there's some crossover that happens in this sport that you can take one skill and bring it into another. And so that was a pass. Had that been a shot and gone out of bounds, it would have been first to the ball. But because it was a pass, it's going to go over to Conard. And so a lot of folks always wonder what's the difference there. Well, that's how the possession would change. In women's lacrosse, you can play full field with everybody, but once you get over what's called the restraining line in this field, it's at about the 30-yard line. You can only go 7v7. So earlier in the game, you might have saw there was a call. It was because Conard had one extra play over. That's called offsides. They'll bring that player back and get a free position. So I'm going to now we're in what's settled offense, 7v7.
14 minutes to go in the opening half. And Conard with the possession, trying to add to their 3-2 lead. In the first matchup that they won 15-5, they had a multiple goal lead to most of the first half until the conclusion, and they have yet to have more than a one goal advantage so far, but we're still early. So off the turnover, Hall comes back in the other direction, and then it's stolen by the Chieftains. And this is Feigenbaum for the Chieftains. Down to the 20-yard line, tries to move around Caroline Grant. Now content to pass it on the perimeter to Geisler. Gwen Geisler. Pass down low. And what's the call there, Steve?
That's what's called shooting space. Because there's no padding, the rules are designed to protect the players. So if you are not within a stick's length of the person with the ball who's in what's called a critical scoring position, you're in what's called shooting space because you're not giving an opportunity for the person with the ball to shoot. So then they get a free position and you gotta go behind. Now there's a number of sort of nuanced calls that folks new to the sport sort of struggle with. there was the same call again. And what frustrates people sometimes is there's no play on it. So a lot of times that shot might go in, and people are like, why don't you give credit for it? Again, it's to really keep everybody safe, and now she's got an even stronger free position from that central angle. Once again, Gabby Gershaw with the terrific.
And unofficially, that's her fourth stop of the opening half. She's got a 57% save percentage, and she would have gotten credit for a stop on the previous shot as well, and that had been called as an infraction. So Tua Candice back the other way, hands it off to Francesca Lynch. As they set things up, Caroline Grant with the ball. We have only two returning starters for this Hall team as they play catch on the perimeter. Pass down low, looking for Cho, and there's that shooting space call again. I would think priority one, if you're Meg Sosimo defensively, you're always trying to keep an eye on Cammie Cho. Is that right, Steve?
That'd be correct. I mean, she's been their most consistent weapon. And right there, Cammie decided to give it up to Lydia Celli, who has a terrific stick and was in a little better angle for the shot there. Lydia probably could have moved the goalie with a fake first, but she tried to pick her spot and hit it, and the goalie read it and did a nice job. And that's Lydia right there riding number eight, Jillian Haverty, and getting the foul.
Last save for Conard by Lauren Scheid, senior goaltender. Started as a freshman for this team, and according to head coach Sir Sosimo, worked very hard in the offseason, and they like her back there because she's a very calm, very stable force as the last line of defense for this Chieftains team. 10.5 to play here in the opening half, clock running. Conard with the ball. And they have the 3-2 advantage over Hall. And Phelan goes in, and I believe that was Phelan who went in and scored.
Yeah, it was a great strong move. She kept her feet moving, and as she was going forward, she did a nice little hitch fake that got Gabby to bite a little bit, and then just went underneath the stick. So that's a real athletic move right there, and a really nice score on her part.
So back-to-back goals, as pointed out by our buddy Bill Watson on the PA this afternoon. 27 on the season for Kylie, who has 4-goal games to her credit this year against both Simsbury and East Catholic. And while she won't play at the next level, she is heading on to the College of Charleston as her plans for the next 4 years. This is Feigenbaum. And the shot, and she scores. Maya Feigenbaum with her 42nd goal of the season on her way to Stony Brook. And I believe a timeout is going to be taken on the field. Comes with 10:04 to play in the opening half. As Conard starting to pull away for the first time this afternoon, they have a 5-2 advantage. The War Chief Sports Council would like to thank our many fine sponsors, including those at the captain's level. They include Hartford Distributors, Franklin Fine Beers, Cork and Bottle, the Babe Ruth Organization, and Coastal Tool, including Rob Ludkin, and the all-conference supporters, Allied Printing, and the Hartford Golf Club. Thanks to one and all for your support of the War Chief Sports Council to make broadcasts like today's games possible today on WHC-TV. Channel 5. First of two for us, as we'll have the boys contest for you at 6, and something a little bit interesting at halftime. I'll let the kids come down. Some youth lacrosse should be fun, Steve.
It's one of the great things about a town like this. Megan and I started a tradition when I came to the helm about doing a joint youth lacrosse clinic. You know, we both recognize that it doesn't matter what part of town you live in, these kids all grow up playing together, and the rivalry should be a competitive and fun one, but at the end of the day, we're all friends. I just saw some parents walk in that are Conard parents that, you know, I grew up going to basketball and soccer games with, as well as lacrosse, and I I want the kids to compete against each other, but some of the silliness that happens with the rivalry is just not healthy. So I think we can model it when we do these youth programs, when we bring the kids here and we help them recognize that sport is about play, it's about friendships, it's about building memories. It's not about creating silly enemies or rivalries that sometimes get manifested in the wrong way.
That's well said, and I'd like to expound on that if I may. I know a lot of towns down where I'm from, down in Wallingford, schools in one town, and there is not that spirit of cooperation like you see here. This is the 13th year covering West Hartford High School sports, and I'm continually amazed by the grace and the continued show of support among one another within the town.
And I think it starts actually, for example, with Meg's father-in-law, Rob, and Frank Robinson, and sort of the history of the family roots that are in this town. We're all role models as coaches, and we need to recognize that. Drives me crazy when I hear things like you're not allowed to shake the hands of the kids from the other team when they come in. And, you know, these are kids, and as adults, we need to be help them understand that this is about relationships, about creating memories. Yes, we want you to compete as hard as you can when you're playing, but do it fairly and do it with class and with grace. Like right there, Josie Lynch just bent down to pick up the kid she did the foul on. That's sportsmanship, and that's what we should be teaching.
Yeah, that was Gwen Geisler who went down, and she starts the attack here for the Chieftains. 5-2, Conard in front, 9.5 to play in the opening half. Conard sets up the attack. Now, if you were in that hall huddle, with the timeout being called because you're down by three for the first time, what do you think Meg Chaplin was telling her kids?
Yeah, again, it's like we talked about at the onset, it's a spurty game. And Conard had one of those quick spurts. Meg's got to make the decision that she could hold her timeout and decide, do I let one more happen? Because she knows she only gets the two timeouts. So there they forced the turnover. Siobhan picked it up and gave it out to Gabby. Now they're in transition. Now, Conard's on what's called the redefend. Kate Schaefer there. Saw that was Anna Grace Tchaikowski who went across the body there looking to get the ball turned over. But they're doing a sort of a zone redefend, trying to keep everybody in front of them. There's a lot of aggressive checks right there. So Meg probably just said, look, let's get possession, let's get down there, let's settle it, let's get the next, let's try to get it back to five, and go into halftime tied if at all possible. It's a nice job with the double team in transition right there.
And Gwen Geisler in possession. Another multi-sport athlete on this team, great runner in track for the Conard Chieftains as they look to set it up. Four unanswered for Conard after they trail 2-1. They look to add to it. Another great save by Gershon that time as she's able to rob Marissa Haverty. So we talked about Haverty and her goal scoring prowess. Had the 6-goal game earlier against Granby. Over 100 career goals. That's not something you see all the time at this level Tuesday.
No, I mean, that's a lot of goals, obviously. And Marissa, again, it's been a common theme. One of the things I've loved about women's lacrosse is I've always called it the multi-sport game. I've known Marissa a long time. She's come through our camp. She's also a swimmer. She's just a kid who really likes to play sports. And this is a perfect game for that sort of kid. And so that's impressive. Anytime you're scoring over 100 goals in a career, again, if you go on my conversion to basketball, it's well over 500 points as a basketball player. That's impressive.
I'm usually pretty silent anyways.
No doubt about it. She'll go down as one of the great goal scorers in Conard history. Long pass up there. It's caught nicely by Caroline Grant. Ball on the attack. This is Cammie Cho trying to find good position. Spins around. Shoots and a nice save there by Lauren Scheid. It was low that time. Use the hockey term, she tried to go five hole between the legs of the goaltender, and Lauren Scheid was up to the task. So Hall has gone a good 12 minutes in between goals at this point. Back the other way come the Chieftains. Again, this is Marissa Haverty, one of three Haverty's on this team. Jillian and Faith as well. Got two sisters and then the cousin. And what's the call there, Steve?
That's just a cross check. If you extend your arms and your elbows get locked and you push, it's like a foul in basketball that you're just not allowed to do. Another great save by Gabby. And she's hustling for because it was a shot. The first person against you. At this point, though, Gabby did earn it and reward it the hustle. The fact she got that, she would have been out of the crease and then probably would have been in trouble. See, Gabby would be real aggressive with her. They call another push foul.
So this not the regular season finale for the Chieftains. They'll end the regular season next Tuesday against Northwest before they get set for the upcoming CIAC state tournament. Kaylee Kennedy with the ball for the Warriors in transition. And then an infraction down at the 30-yard line. Ball back in play as they battle for it. And the Chieftains will come away with it. And here's Gwen Geisler speeding down into the attack zone. Goes in, shoots and scores. Pretty move that time as Geisler with a little hesitation move able to pick the corner that time on Gershon to make it 6-2.
Yeah, again, a couple of unforced errors are really really hurting Hall at this time. It created the 2-on-1 fast break right there. Antu Okangas actually did a nice job. She's a transfer from basketball as well who positioned herself to cover the two of them. But there was a nice little look off there, and Gwen kept it and just picked her spot and popped it over Gabby's head right there. It's, a pretty goal on her part. But 2v1 in that situation, definite advantage to the offense in that case.
Just as you would see in the odd man rush in hockey or even a fast break in basketball, you have that advantage, and you're almost always going to have a good advantage to cash in.
Exactly, and that's one of the things like you would in those two sports and lacrosse as well. You practice those man-up transition opportunities. You want to take advantage of them when you can, because it's a lot easier to score when you have what's called the numbers, 4v2, 3v1, 3v2. Anytime you have advantage offense over defense, you want to take it when you can, especially if you're the superior offensive team, because you want to try to create separation. In some cases, if you're trying to keep the score low and you've got a lead, you might want to, and you're not predicted to win, you might not want to take that shot. But in Conard's case right now, they want to create as much gap as they can to spread this lead out.
And they're looking for more. As Marissa Haverty in control, passes it off. This is Geisler now. Jillian Haverty passes it back out top, back to Marissa. Exercising patience here. Is this also a product of the fact that they have the big lead and maybe working sometimes, Steve?
Probably a combination of both. I mean, certainly now there's Gabby Gershon once again. I don't know how many that is, maybe 7 or 8 at this point. So again, if you don't have a good goalie in there, this game could be out of control, but she's keeping them in it. Yeah, I think it could be a function though too of just, Hall is working very hard on the defensive end. They've actually had a lot of practice on it because of how much they've struggled offensively and in the midfield. They've had a lot of opportunities to, work on that defensive side. They do a good job communicating. Here's some transition with Hall will probably settle it and take the first good option that they get. There's Cammy Cho. Again, nice save.
Tremendous save by Scheid, who's made 3 in a row to keep Hall off the scoreboard again. So Scheid, the senior, and she's played in a bunch of these contests, so she knows all about this Conard-Hall rivalry firsthand. This is Geisler passing you off, and here comes Conard back in the other direction. Jillian Haverty speeds through in transition. down the left-hand side, pulls up outside the 20-yard line. This is Feigenbaum. Has a lane, and the shot is blocked at the defense, and it goes to the goaltender. So it's deflected on the way in, and Gershon able to control for all. Less than 2 minutes to play here in this opening half. Big possessions for Hall upcoming. Certainly want to slice into that lead and take a little bit of momentum into halftime. Well, the 10-minute break at halftime upcoming for the juniors to play. As Hall very, very patient, standing at the 40-yard line. So they look to regroup and set the attack. They'd also like to get out the scoreboard for the first time in what has seemed like an eternity for them. It's been about 17 minutes since the last time they were able to beat Lauren Shy to get back of the net. What is Gershon waiting to develop here?
Well, you know, they have a choice at this point. Sometimes you're going to do the equivalent of like waiting for the last shot. I'm not sure that's what they were doing. It's just that Conard chose not to cover the goalie. And as a result, they're thinking, yeah, we got the lead. We'll let them run as long as they want. That's what's called a check in girls lacrosse. It's a different form of a check than it would be in boys lacrosse. You can't go into the sphere. That's a pretty hard check, though, I have to tell you, because Kimmy actually lost her stick in the process. She looked at the ref thinking it would be what's called a held check. In other words, you can't check pushing through. You're supposed to hit it and back. She didn't in that case. But it actually looked like a clean check to me from here.
Coach Conard on the attack. It's passed down low. And save by Gershon. She comes up big. She robbed Katie Schaefer that time from close range. And this will probably upcoming be the final possession of this opening half. 10 seconds to go, less than 10 seconds. Long pass downfield. Ball's going to be loose. And that'll do it as time winds down in the opening half. So competitive for the first 7 or 8 minutes or so. Hall actually had a 2-1 advantage. The final 5 goals of the opening half go to the homestand of Chieftains. And at halftime, the score, it is Conard 6 and Hall 2. The War Chief Sports Council would like to thank our many fine sponsors, including those at the varsity level, Low Tide Photography, Cork and Bottle, Blue Plate, Fast Eddie, Dave Newman Photography, West Hartford Youth Basketball, West Hartford Boys Travel Basketball, the Open Arm Christian Ministries, Final Cut Barbershop, Edward Conard's Insurance Agency, Stanley and LA Phillips, Beth Barry Brown of the William Ravis Agency, and West Hartford Girls Lacrosse. Thanks to One and All for your sponsorship. West Hartford High School Sports and the War Chief Sports Council. Broadcast live today to you on WNC-TV, Channel 5. And we're at halftime, and the score is Conard 6 and Hall 2. Steve Boyle and I will come back with more a little bit later on. Again, you're watching West Hartford High School Sports on WNC-TV, Channel 5.
Did I have time to run to my car and grab a rain jacket? Alright, I'm going.
And we're set for the second half. Conard in front, 6-2. Welcome back, everybody. Pete Lamoureux along with Steve Boyle and our fine crew. Meredith, Diana, Jen leading the way. A lot of volunteer photographers as well, helping us put the game on the air to you. And first possession of the second half going to Hall. Here's Chelly. And Olivia Pomerleau. Here's Grant on the perimeter. Now it's Chelly. Nordyke with one of her first touches, 34-goal scorer, really hasn't seen a lot of the ball so far, Steve.
Yeah, again, we talked about it on the onset that possession is so important, and Natalie's a real good weapon when she can get the ball at the top of the crease. She tends to score well from the attack. So that was a check in the sphere. So we've got Lydia Chelly with the free position from the right side. She went for it, but didn't really move the goalie, and we got another save.
In hockey, we call that a telegraph shot. Shower coming down. Make the field a little bit wet for playing here in the second half. Got it on the first attack of the third quarter. On the perimeter, this is Geisler with the moves. Cuts to her right, spins back. Didn't have a lane and comes back outside. Now to Feigenbaum. Good defense again by Hall, but Feigenbaum finds a lane, goes in, shoots and scores. Maya Feigenbaum, 40-plus goal scorer. First goal of the second half. Six unanswered for Conard, and they open up a 7-2 advantage.
Yeah, Maya Feigenbaum, like a lot of girls in this town that meet with success, came to Lacrosse late. My middle daughter actually grew up playing soccer and then basketball with her. And Maya has found her niche, particularly with lacrosse, and maybe playing at one of the top Division I programs in the United States. Anytime you're playing anywhere on Long Island, Division I, you're playing at a quality program. Maya is a natural lefty, and as such has that advantage of being able to score from that side in particular, even though she can certainly use both hands very well. That was a nice pickup off the draw control by Caroline Grant.
And now Hall back on the attack. Down 5, 2 minutes have gone by here in the second half. Perimeter, this is Nordyke. Back of the net, Josephine Lynch, senior captain. One of the hardest workers on this team, according to her head coach, Meg Chaplin. Pass is deflected, and a good job by Connor to steal, and they transition back in the other direction. Nice pass in the middle. No angle for Harry. Backs it back out. Gwen Geisler. She's in. She shoots and it goes wide. It's a Conard team. When you look at their overall mark on the year, talked about their 8-game winning streak and the fact that they're 10 games over the 500 mark. They have a plus 101 goal scoring differential. And they try to go low. And was that a stop? By the net line. Yeah, the first shot. Making the stop. Unofficially, 10 saves. And her save percentage this afternoon is approaching 60.
She's been outstanding. Defense is doing a nice job of trying to force difficult shots. Defense in women's lacrosse is comparable to basketball in that you do want to be able to pressure the ball, but you can play a zone. Conard's actually playing what's called a backer zone. I'll talk about that in a second. But in girls lacrosse, you have to be within a stick's length of your player. So you can't do a true help position. You either got to double team or you got to stay on your man within a stick's length. All right? So there's a breakthrough. There's a nice ball from Gabby to Chavon. All right, should we shoot his bracelet from the angle I had? Sure enough, it was. Because the person went into that help position in the pass window, she was stuck in the shooting space was there. That looks like Cammie Cho from here on a nice angle for the free position. On the whistle, she can go right to goal, and she finishes hard. It's a good goal.
She made it look so easy, as a 50-plus goal scorer in one season would. And that ends an extended drought for Paul, who unofficially had not scored since about the 18-minute mark. So that's the case. It's almost 23 minutes. It's now 7-3 for Paul scoring on the stadium. As we progress through the broadcast, I want to talk about your endeavor at 241sports.com. Modern's life is too short for just one sport. We've been all over Denver, Washington, D.C. most recently. Nice little meeting with the First Lady. Talk about the endeavor and talk about your recent trips, if you would.
Sure. Thanks, Pete. It'll be hard for me to be talking about this while I'm watching such good lacrosse out here, but certainly this is a product of what physical literacy is all about. The definition of physical literacy, the U.S. definition that is the ability and confidence and the desire to be active for life. And so it's terrific to be able to see these young women out here hopefully playing a sport that they're going to want to play for the rest of their lives. And this is going to be a great So sure enough, I think as a lot of folks know in town, we started a program back in 2008, actually, to counter the specialization that we were seeing in youth sports.
You have a lot of folks
in the room. A local soccer coach said to my daughter after trying out for the soccer team that he was her number one prospect. But when he learned she was actually interested in lacrosse, he said, we're no longer interested. So my wife and I said, well, we could shout from the mountaintops and do something. And we infiltrated. We went to the local leagues, and we got everyone to endorse the concept. And last year, we were recognized as one of 8 model programs in the United States by the Aspen Institute. And just this last Tuesday, I actually got to be on stage with the First Lady, and where she was endorsing the concept of physical literacy and the need for play in reimagining youth sports. And we got recognized once again because we're reintroducing free play into our curriculum. We're teaching a small-sided way of playing games and getting kids active, and it's been really fun.
Well, congratulations on your achievements so far, and talk about the Sports Academy this summer at Kingswood Oxford.
Yeah, it's again, that growth has been terrific. After the first year of having just girls, the moms and dads who were dropping off their daughters said, can you please do this for boys as well? And could you do it for more than 1 week? And, you know, certainly they become our marketers. It was a word-of-mouth endeavor. And so we've got over... We expect about 600 kids probably will go through our program over the 2-week period. 11 different options that the kids can choose from. From lacrosse to tennis to football to baseball to soccer. Something called universal sports where they can try different sports like fencing, team handball. We actually have First Tee coming to do a day of golf with us. It's really grown into something pretty special, so much so that there's a school in Denver, Colorado, who liked our model so much that they're going to be doing a version of 241 Sports out in Denver 2 weeks after our camp here. So next year we have a school in Pasadena, California that wants to take the camp there. Probably more importantly is that before the school program, we'll be working with disadvantaged kids who otherwise couldn't afford programs like ours are going to have an advantage to do it through what we call the Plus Club, physical literacy using sports sampling, where we also actually teach healthy cooking, gardening, and mindfulness infused into all of our programs. The Boys and Girls Clubs of America, YMCA, the JCCs, all the national organizations are looking at our model and considering bringing it into their organizations.
That's great. Good stuff, that's for sure. And lacrosse, part of it, 7-3 to score, 17 minutes to go. We're in regulation time. Shelley. Passing by the Warriors.
This is actually a defensive 3 seconds. So what was happening was it looked like the defender was in the 8 meter arc, not covering anybody for more than 3 seconds. That's not allowed. Like we talked about before, you have to be within a stick's length of your player. So she was in a help position, which is an unsafe position, and she got called for that 3 second call. It's not often called, but if it's blatant, refs will often see it, and sometimes a coach will be hollering for it to make sure that you're yelling, make sure you're covering people outside. Make sure the call is
She's definitely frustrated after she was stopped by Lauren Shy, who in her own right has played exceptionally well in the nets for Conard here this afternoon. She has stopped unofficially 5 of the last 6 shots on goal by the Hall Warriors. The Warrior Chief Sports Council would like to thank our many fine sponsors, including those at the all-state level. PETA Insurance, Magga Plumbing and Heating, Reed and Reed PC Counselors of Law, ESPN, the Conard and Hall PTO, and Mr. and Mrs. Jonathan Gibson. Thanks to one and all for your patronage of the War Chief Sports Council. 15-16 to go here in the contest, and it's bounced home. They score. So there's Geisler with the goal. Third of the afternoon. Excel Center, we'd see the hats flying.
Yeah, Gwen's had a nice game. She did a nice job on that finish. It's very difficult for a goalie to stop that bad shot because you have to put it in the angle in such a way that you know it's going to pop up, and you're not sure how high depending on where it hits the turf. So even the most experienced of goalies at the top level struggle with that particular shot.
Is that a shot that you would advocate from time to time? And if so, when's the best opportunity to do so?
Well, I would advocate for it 80 to 90% of the time from that position because it is such a difficult shot. That's a great draw control right there from Caroline Grant. Siobhan on the draw does a nice job of pulling it back to her teammate, and now they're in transition. This has been a struggle for Hall in the midfield, just being able to get it from possession to the center of offense. But to go back to that shot, if you're so far that you're not able to move the goalie or the fake's not going to do what you want it to do, then you might as well go ahead and go for that bad shot. A high shot from that distance is an easy
save. To expand upon your more recent point, making the comparison to hockey, where now so much conscious effort is made into defending in the neutral zone, how important is it to defend in the neutral zone, the midfield area?
Well, it's huge. Before I talk about that, so that's a yellow card right there. It's called a slash. And so Connor's going to have to play the man down for 2 minutes. And it's not releasable like it is in some sports. So what it means is that Hall's going to get to spend the next 2 minutes, whether they score or not, going 7v6. So they're going to want to try to score early and often here because you want to get as many of the goals back as you can in this position. So that's a costly turnover right there because now the 2 minutes that they had with possession, Conard can either choose to go ahead and score, so they're going to play 6v7 on the other end, or they can go ahead and run the penalty. So here's to your point. Conard does a really simple job of breaking over the top. We were pretty top heavy on that lead defend, and now Conard's on attack. So that neutral zone we're talking about, that's key. If you can force turnovers there, you gain that possession. That's so important in this particular sport, and it allows you to do some things, especially when you have a lead, that you otherwise would feel forced into doing. So Conard can really dictate how they want to do this. So at this point, you know, they're looking to score, but they're also looking to run some clock. They got a pretty comfortable lead, and that's a foul right there.
So, again, you can make the analogy to hockey that you're just penalty killing, you just knock all the time off the clock that you possibly can. Play a little keeper run, target for an offense, shot clock. So, here's Geisler. Tries to spin out of a double team. Gets her pass to Marissa Haverty.
Hall's double teaming now because they're man up. They're trying to get that, you know, Conard they know is trying to kill the penalty. So they're strongly double teaming where they can, but Connor's doing a really nice job of possessing and breaking those double teams.
Phelan passes it to Schaefer. Some impatience on the fans here on the outside. Good job. Ball control running off that penalty tile. That's a nice pass. And Schaefer was about to go in for a shot. And we have a whistle and another infraction on the play.
Yeah, that's another shooting space. So what happened is they did a nice job of spreading everybody out, and Kate just got wide open there. It's a nice job, though, on the free position defense. Got a stick in there and knocked the shot down, made it an easy pickup for Gabby. Not sure she'll get credit for a save there, but she certainly would like to get one.
That's an easy one. Helped by the defense. Pass in midfield intended for Rosini. It's loose. And she has it for Conard. Maggie, a sophomore defender, terrific speed. Meg Sursasamu talks about her great footwork from basketball and soccer. So another three-sport athlete, and we see a lot of them on both sides of the field here this afternoon. Good defense by the Warriors, keeping Feigenbaum from shooting. Now it's Geisler. Looking for her fourth of the afternoon. Good pass in front, and the shot, and they score. Beautiful pass. And Feigenbaum with the goal. And Conard extends their lead.
I can see the Hall coaches deciding right now whether or not they want to use their timeout with six goals down, 10:53. It's a tough decision because they only get one more. Yeah, and Coach Meg is making the right decision right there, because at this point, unless you do something, Connor's going to be able to possess. Once they get possession, they can just run off clock. So they got to make some adjustments, and it's a good timeout right there.
And it comes with 10:53.
Ladies and gentlemen, just to make you aware, WHC TV Channel 5 is broadcasting and taping today's game. Both the boys and the girls, we broadcast. That'll be on the 28th. Girls game at 7 p.m. and the boys game at 9 p.m. Again, that's Channel 5. We broadcast on the 28th of May. 7 p.m. for the girls and 9 p.m. for
the all conference. Include Allied Printing and the Hartford Golf Club. Thanks to one and all for your support of the War Chief Sports Council, and games able to be broadcast here on WHC-TV, Channel 5. A reminder, we'll have the boys contest if you're watching live here this afternoon. It comes up at 6 o'clock tonight. And then our final broadcast of the spring season will take us to the University of Hartford baseball field on Monday afternoon, May the 23rd. First pitch at 4:30. The annual Mayor's Cup battle as Hall takes on Conard. Rematch of the game earlier in the season, won by the Warriors. But Conard winning last year's Mayor's Cup, and they won it, Steve, with a Hall runner thrown out of the plate trying to steal Hall.
He was at the game. The runner's Neil Kelly, who actually is that we run is we have so much affiliation with the folks in town. So there's a number of kids in this game in particular that came through our camp on both sides. Certainly Coach Billing has been one of our longtime staffers. Coach Von Meyerhauser is on our staff. He's going to be coaching the boys lacrosse in a bit. And Neil Kelly is going to be, who's going to school in California, is going to be one of our staffers this summer. So that was a wonderful baseball game. Actually, Pat McHale, another one of our counselors, had a great pickoff during that game and kept them in. And to steal home and to end on something like that, it was just fun sports to watch. And I think even on the losing side, they went down swinging. It was fun to watch.
Good time for former Conard coach to talk about Cup action live on WHC-TV Channel 5 next Monday, May 23rd, 4:30, the first pitch. So after the timeout, 9-3 the score, Conard in front with 10:53. Time remaining. boys will take center stage at 6 tonight. Had a chance to see the boys contest against NFA on Saturday, and they were quite impressive, piling up the goals and winning in that one. Here's Cho speeding towards net with a shot and a save made by the goaltender Shy. 6 saves for her in the last 7 shot attempts for the Warriors. She has been absolutely terrific as well. Great goaltender.
Yeah, she really has done a nice job. And I think in that case, we talked about it earlier, Cammy would probably, when she looked at the film, so she might have thought about bouncing that one. From that distance, unless you've got an absolute rocket, it makes it a little bit easier for that goalie to pick up on save. So a little bad shot that would be good. I'm sure her sister Hannah Cho, who's playing at Vassar College right now, would be saying the same thing to her, like the good big sister would. Yeah. Now Cammy's a terrific athlete and obviously is doing a great job of helping Hall hang around. But as the competitor she is, she doesn't want to take that shot back and do something a little more aggressive.
If you talk about one goaltender on one end, the other end, score shot making the save. Off a pretty move by Marissa Haver. Circled the net that time and walked right out in front and was completely unopposed and took the shot, and Gershon was equal to the task. Good pass down low, gets away, and it's going to be chased down by Scheid, the netminder. Again, we talked about Conard and their winning streak and the fact that they'll end their season next Tuesday against Northwest. Hall will finish their season at home. They have a game at Chalmers Stadium next Monday against Danbury, and that'll be their 16th and final regular season game of the 2016 campaign. Here come the Chieftains on the attack. There's Feigenbaum. Perimeter passing. Katie Schaefer's had a good game this afternoon for the Chieftains. Back of the net as they rotate. Again, Steve, as you put your coaching hat on again for a second, pretty good defense by Hall this afternoon. I don't think that's one of the areas. Again, great goaltending right there and a great save by Gershon.
Yeah, look, against a team like Conard, who's got the record that they have, to have only let up 9 goals at this point is pretty impressive. Gabby's been pretty good. They do a really good job. They've come a long way in terms of their communication skills. Again, it's like basketball. If you don't talk, you're much weaker as a unit. So I think they've got a chance to get a lot stronger. You can see right there, they're getting tired. So that's a check that they really... It's a free position that is really putting an advantage right now. I think they're getting tired because down 6 goals, you have to be hyper-aggressive to try to earn the ball back, and it gets real challenging at this point, especially against a team that has 7 players with the sticks on that side that Conard does.
Good bounce shot, and it goes in for the Chieftains as they hit double figures as Sarah Mahon scores.
Conard double digits.
Young lady who's bound for the University of New Hampshire. Soccer player, a good lacrosse player as well. We talked about Paul defensively. See, Conard team with 185 goals coming in, they have 195 now for the season. They're averaging between 15 and 16 per contest, so we're looking at it from an average standpoint right now. Playing on their home turf. Job pretty well done in that respect.
Yes, again, I mean, certainly if they choose to, they have a chance to put 4 or 5 more back up. But I also, you know, what I like about both programs this year is that, you know, Megs can look back on this season and say, oh, our record is what it is. But let's be clear that she gets to choose many of the games and the opponents she goes against. So she could have scheduled some wins, and it could look a little bit different. But I think she has the long-term vision of being able to say, you don't get better playing against weaker opponents. We're a young team. We need to go against top competition so that down the line we know what it's like. So I think this tough schedule this year is going to pay off for this young group moving forward. That's a great save. That did a really nice job of moving the goalie, but Gabby stuck with it and is really keeping him in the game.
Camry speeds into the attack zone. Good pass. And the whistle on the play again. Shooting space violation once again. But to elaborate on your point that you were talking about the schedule making, Megster Sosimo told me the same thing. She said the best way to get her team completely prepared for the tournament is to have the toughest schedule that she possibly can. And I think long-term, Meg Chaplin shares that same vision.
Yeah, well, Meg was my assistant, as you know, my first year. And we, you know, I inherited a program without much experience as a coach. And it can go to your head pretty quickly, all right? So we go in, and I think we were something like 13-3, and we thought we were all that. And then we got to the second round. We got a cupcake game in the first round. We got to the second round, and it was the major leagues. And I realized at that point that we weren't doing ourselves any favors by playing against weaker opponents. And to get to the point where you can literally pick a scoreboard which you want to win by, no one's going to win on the other side. So I think it's an important lesson for these kids to say, look, it's okay to have the record you have as long as you allow it to motivate you and you've allowed yourself to learn from the experience and say to yourself, we can get back to the point. That's a great goal by Lydia Celli right there. She switches really nicely from the right side to the left side. And she's one of those kids that, you know, you wouldn't know which hand she was because she spent a lot of time on the wall, and she's a very, very good finisher.
She's obviously a good dynamic scorer. She proved once again 40-plus goals. She's going to play intramurals at Penn State next year. She's off to.
Ooh, is she dumbass?
She's a good football team. That's on the rise. 10-4 the score. 6-2 at halftime, as we talked about, and since the intermission, Conard has a 4-2 advantage in this second half. 5.5 to play as they battle for the ball, and Geisler comes away with it for Conard, leading the attack. Toussaint gets it back outside as they play catch on the perimeter. Man the Geisler. Pass goes awry, but it's scooped up behind the net by a fellow chieftain. The good recovery that time was made by Tchaikovsky. Back outside, Jillian Haverty with the ball now. To Marissa. And back to Geisler. Does some of the coaching mentality, Steve, now come into effect that you got the lead, you're winding the time down, not only do you want to run the clock out, but maybe show some good sportsmanship and not take scores?
Yeah, you know, again, that's going to be a philosophy thing. You know, certainly, at this point, Meg recognizes that she's probably got this game. It's 11-4 at this point. When you get to a mercy rule, when you get to a 10-goal lead, sometimes it is merciful. You get to 10, and it helps to run the clock out. And you typically try not to score after that point when you know you've got the win. Now, Meg's entering the state tournament, though. She's going to have a nice seed, highest seed she's had. She probably believes she has a legitimate chance as to make a really deep run into the tournament. And so you want to keep the kids hungry, but you also want to maintain that sportsmanship. So it's always a balancing act to try to do both. And, you know, I know Meg to be a class act, and she's going to make the choice that's best for her team, for her program, without looking to embarrass anybody.
11-4 the score. Chieftains set up again on offense. Nice move in front, and they score. Pretty scoring maneuver right there.
I have to give props to Anna Grace Tchaikovsky, who I've had a chance to know growing up over the years. Her dad has been a pipe-piper of youth sports in this town, involved in basketball, lacrosse, field hockey, and just a great guy and a great ambassador for sports. And he's only a freshman, and that's a nice little move right there. So congrats to her on that goal.
She's been quite the prolific scorer in JV. 30-plus goals at the JV level, and as Megster Sosimo told me, Anna definitely will be a starter next year for sure. Here comes Hall on the attack. 12-4 now the score. Here's Cho with the shot, and the save is made. Looked like that play, she ran into some good defense and didn't really get all into the shot that time. It was a little bit of an easy save for shot.
Yeah, interestingly enough, it was a charge call earlier in the game, but I didn't really think it was a charge call. Right there, you know, Cammy's competitive. She's trying to do what she can to get home. I think she forced her a little bit. She had the free position. But you can tell Hall's fatigued at this point. They're trying very hard to make themselves into a good athletic team. They are fatigued. But, you know, they're putting up a good fight against one of the best teams in the state. And they're going to keep competing to the end.
Good stop. That's a shot. Stopping Marissa Haverly that time. Talked about Marissa will play at the next level. Going to Assumption. Pretty famous Assumption of all these players and names. James Calhoun. Basketball, many years ago. Boyle, she spins, and now Conard comes back the other way. Types of measures go through.
Spahn, as you referenced earlier, took a check to the head about five games ago and didn't immediately show signs, and certainly. Thankfully, with all the national precautions that are going on around concussion and concussion awareness, you walk that tightrope as a parent sometimes, of saying, is it truly what it is? And it's really nice that you take that power from the parents that might be wanting their kid to get back into play and to make sure you're following proper protocols. So in Siobhan's case, there's something called the impact test that everyone takes. It's a baseline test. She also got evaluated by her pediatrician. And there's a return to play protocol, because a lot of times kids will lie, they'll fake, they'll say they're fine, but making kids go through that return to play protocol, you're really making sure that that they're safe. You know, as parents, we worry about brains and knees. But knees can be repaired, and brains cannot. And so we want to make sure we're taking proper precautions. Was it a bummer for us as parents to not be able to see her play? Look, she's going to play a lot of games and a lot of sports. She's going to carry that brain with her for the rest of her life. So seeing all four or five games is not a good thing. It's a nice pickup right there.
And here come the Chieftains in the other direction. Maggie Venora has it for Conard. And she passes it back behind the net. 1 minute to go as Conard takes the shot and they score. Kylie Phelan. Right to the left
with
of the net line at that time.
For Conard.
And that'll make it 13-4 with 56 seconds to go. In your 4 years at the helm of Hall, did you see a lot of concussions? Is that an injury that's prevalent in the sport?
You know, actually, there's a lot of debate about whether or not girls should get helmets for lacrosse. And my feeling is that absolutely not. The rules are designed to protect the players. The referees' jobs and the coaches' jobs to make sure they understand the rules and that they're enforcing the rules. My feeling is once you put helmets on kids, it's going to increase the aggression. And look, one of the worst concussions I ever saw was one of my players my first year. She was snowboarding and had a helmet on. She fell with a helmet on and missed almost 4 months of school. And so if you put a helmet on a kid, you're going to be way more aggressive, you're going to have other body part injuries, and kids are going to fall more and hit their heads on the way down. And these kids aren't trained necessarily for neck muscle to be able to sustain that. The concussions I see are because kids are being taught to be overly aggressive or because of fluke things, like walking in front of a pass or not paying attention during a drill and catching a ball to the head. I see concussions happening much more in soccer and basketball than I do in lacrosse, certainly.
Well said on a very current topic to talk about in a lot of different sports, that's for sure. Conard running the clock out as they are going to be content to walk away with a 9-goal victory, and you hear the buzzer sounding ending the contest. As they go to congratulate their netminder, Lauren Schein, as they win by the score of 13-4.
Congratulations, ladies, a well-fought contest.
7-2 in the second, after leading 6-2 at the break. As they improved 13-2 with their ninth consecutive win, Hall falls to 3-12.
On Tuesday of next week, a 4 o'clock start versus Northwest Catholic.
Steve, it's a pleasure having you. Did a fine job.
If you can stick around in 30 minutes, Conard will face off against the boys from Hall.
Thanks for having me, Pete. It was a lot of fun. If you choose to watch a rebroadcast
of either of today's games, they'll
really
be on WHCT TV at Channel 5 on May 28th.
They'll
be broadcast at 7
Steve
and the boys
Boyle.
At 9.
Longtime Hall girls coach, former coach, joining us in the broadcast booth here today as the Conard Chieftains sweep the season series from Hall. They won 15-5 on April 2nd. They went 13-4 here this afternoon. 13-2 is their record as Hall falls to 3-12. We're going to take a brief timeout, and we hope to be joined by Megster Sasebo and one of the players of the victorious Chieftains. Again, final score, Conard 13, Hall 4. Back with more after this. You're watching West Hartford High School Sports as presented by the Warchief Sports Council here on WHC-TV Channel 5. Back in a moment.
It's a lot of fun. It's really cool up here. What time should I be in a baseball game on Monday? Meredith!
Come on.